Would you do you have any comments on the recording of Double Fantasy? How that record came together? Was John sort of gone through a period when he hadn't been in the studio for a while and he was doing demos at home? Is that how I understand?
No, the demos were done in Bermuda.
Oh, okay.
And he sent them to me. And in all honesty, I mean, they were very primitive. They were recorded directly on a cassette.
Oh.
So they were recorded on a blaster. Like a Panasonic blaster.
Oh, he was just literally home demos.
Yeah, these were really home demos. So he would record it right onto the Panasonic with mm-hmm. the microphones built in. And yeah. then he had two of these.
Right, okay.
And then he would play it back from that one and do an overdub.
That's how I used to do it when I was a kid.
Yeah, yeah, and then double the vocal on the as it went into the other one. Yeah, as it went into the other one, then he...
Genius.
Then he had a collection of all these songs, and he sent them to me, and I thought, when I heard them, that I couldn't beat it, really, because it had such an ambience and mm-hmm. a feel to it. That,
yeah.
I mean, it was...
An intimate feeling.
Yeah, the drums were Fred Seaman building... banging on a pot in a pan.
Yeah.
That was the drums in the background.
That's great. That's so crazy. Because that's how me and my friends used to do it when we were kids.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have instruments.
Right.
It's ironic that our legend, this iconic, superstar we are emulating, is doing it the same way.
I suppose if he weren't in Bermuda, he would go
he
into
a studio.
Or even his home setup, which he had around his bed, was quite amazing. But, and then Yoko gave me a stack of tapes, and she said, "Here's stuff to consider for my album, which she'd recorded on a piano and vocal mostly, mm-hmm. in the mansion in Long Island Sound." So I sorted through all the stuff.
Yeah,
it turned out to be really four records that I was making. You had two artists. And there was enough material for two albums.
Okay.
Because it was Milk and Honey, and which was all live vocals, because John was, luckily I did live vocals on everything did.
From the pre-production, basically?
No, from the studio. When we did the tracks, I always had him singing live.
Oh, I see.
And a lot of those vocals were used even on Double Fantasy, Yeah. But on Milk and Honey, those are only the live vocals.
Oh, I see. That's all that was there.
Yes, all we had. Anyway, that record was a secret while we were in pre-production. I mean, not even the musicians knew.
Yeah, that's the story. I heard that you sang the lead vocals while the musicians were working.
Yeah, we rehearsed at SIR, and a guy named Tony DeVillo and I, we did the charts. We wrote out charts from the music on the cassette, and I did arrangements.
Wow.
And then we would go into rehearsal, and I would hand out the charts. Mm-hmm. And then the band would play, and I would sing terribly, an octave lower than John. And then I would record the rehearsal, and then I would run back to the Dakota mm-hmm. and jump into bed with John, because he liked to work in his bed, which is really cool.
It's like the living room, essentially.
Yeah, yeah. You'd be in bed, you'd be surrounded by equipment, you'd have two guitars behind him, you'd have piano over here, tape recorder, TV, all this stuff.
Wow.
Electric piano over there. Mm-hmm. And I'd jump in there, we'd listen to the cassette of rehearsal, and he'd suggest changes, and then I would make notes of the changes, and then go back to rehearsal and make the changes. And the band didn't know for weeks whose record they liked the material, didn't care for the vocals very much.
Before we began this interview, you were telling me about the Double Fantasy acoustic album.
Oh, yeah.
Album
well,
gonna be
yeah, I'm going to revisit that later this month back in New York.
That's really interesting.
For EMI and for Yoko. Or for Yoko and for EMI. I'll be remixing it. A unplugged version of the whole album.
Wow, that's going to be really cool to listen to.
Yeah, I have a lot of research to do. I have to go back to the original tapes. And when I recorded it, it was recorded on two tape machines. Mm. It was recorded on a 16-track, 2-inch. I did my bass tracks on the 16-inch, and then, on the 16-track, 2-inch, and then I bounced work tracks to the 24 track.
Oh.
You know, like a mix.
I see.
And then I did my overdubs on the 24 until, you know, there was only a mono track left of that. You know, I'd be bounced down, I filled the 24, and then I ran both machines at the same time when I was mixing in sync.
That's cool.
It's actually 15 tracks and 23 tracks because you have sync on both of them. And then they'll run together. And
that's how you made it happen before Pro Tools.
Yeah, so now I have to, I'll bake the tapes.
Uh-huh.
And then I'll bounce one at a time, the 16 track, and then the 24, you know, at 192.
Okay.
And then lock them up. You know, that will be really easy in Pro Tools compared to what it was like with two machines.
Yeah, so you definitely, you've embraced the new technology of Pro Tools and assembly.
Well, here I am.
I know, here it is.
Right, I mean, there. I honestly prefer to go to tape first and then come off the tape head and go right into Pro Tools to get the sound of tape. But I see, this is Jack's rack over here.
Uh-huh.
And
this is all your APIs. Yeah.
Yeah, nice. And this Charisma is a really a nice gadget because it's a tape emulator.
Mm.
It's just a bunch of tubes. Mm-hmm. But it really will emulate the sound of tape. And when I have to go for it, they don't have tape yet.
Mm-hmm.
So now I have to come off of...
get your own...
Yeah, I come off Pro Tools and then go into this.
Yeah.
And these mic pre's are also... Well, it's four mic pre's or four line amps. And they're from a... they're from a 1963, I believe it is, Crown tape recorder. And
oh,
I pulled the electronics out and I sent them to Pro Audio Design in Massachusetts.
So this is your custom rack.
And they rebuilt it and now, you know, it's just a fabulous line amps or mic pre's. And, and last week, while I was up in San Francisco, I managed to come across some 1952s, really, talk about vintage.
Wow.
Ampex tape, mono tape machines.
Yeah.
The 601s, which are like the rarest, they were field recorders. And they were built like tanks so they could go into the field and record. I pulled the mic pre's out and they're wrapped up now and they're in my car. And tomorrow they're going to Texas for a rebuild.
That's a serious one of a kind.
Very serious, very serious. And then there's the new Culture Vulture from England. The rest is pretty much pretty stock stuff.
Yeah.
We won't even talk about my vocoder. It's very good. And how I use it, but it's not the obvious ways.
It's not the obvious way? You're not going to give us the secret on that, huh? Oh, boy. Okay, well, we got to peek at the actual unit then.
And then there were, you know, the rest of the stuff is in here. I'm sending out some more stuff. I live in New York.
Uh-huh.
So when I go back, I have a few more things. I seem to be doing more work out here than I am in New York. I'm sorry, you have more questions.
Well, it's great to hear you just keep going. It's fantastic. You described the gear and how you're using it. If I go back to the script, I did have a question about John Lennon. I know, I'm sure you get questions all the time about John Lennon, but understandably so. He's such a legendary and a figure in music, continues to inspire people nowadays. And I was just wondering if you could tell us.
Because of him, I get discounts on equipment. I mean, it's like crazy. I'm sending that piece of equipment back. And the guy quotes me a price on, you know, on what it's going to cost to rebuild it, restore it, and make it modern.
Uh-huh.
And then he finds out who
it's
I am.
For.
And, yeah, it's for me. And then he says, "Yo, I can't. I have to give you a discount because John Lennon's the patron saint of my shop.
And see, his
picture hangs over everything. So he made me a really nice offer. He was very kind. Frank Miller.
Wow.
Or Jim Miller. Jim Miller.
So,
Texas.
Yeah, you're honored in that, with that so many different ways.